Welcome to the IVM Podcast Network.
You're listening to Paobites with the Daily Pao.
This is Pronuti,
Amit,
and Purva,
and we're from the Daily Pao, a Bombay-specific culture and food website. And this is our mini-series of podcasts. It's called Paobites, and we run it in the weeks between our fortnightly podcast, the Paodcast. So in this episode of Paobites, we're going to talk to Sakshi, who is one of the founding members of Gaysi Family, and it's an online platform for the LGBT community, right?
Yep.
Okay. So now there. since we thought that we'd start this discussion by talking about the new video, which is out. It's by Nanok, who is an electronic...
He's an electronic musician, Nanok, a.k.a. Jay Vaswani.
Jay Vaswani.
Who also owns a chain of fries shops called the Jay.
But right.
The reason a lot of people are talking about this video is because it stars Monica Dogra and Anushka Manchanda. And for those who have seen the video, who would you like... Purva, would you like to describe it?
Why am I nominated for this? It's basically Monica and Anushka are a couple, and they're making out in the video.
And it's pretty brave because we haven't actually seen anything like this before, especially in Indian music video. I mean, there have been depictions of same-sex relationships but in a couple of videos, and I've seen another one that was animated. But this one, I think it was by Surreal Soldiers. Was the last one that I saw. But that's not the only reason why we're talking to you, Sakshi. But I think it just coincidentally happened to be,
This is newsworthy. Yeah. So what has been the reaction among the LGBT community? I mean, is this significant in any way? Because, I mean, for example, Mumbai Mirror carried a piece on it and they talked about how this video has been made in support of the LGBT community. So what's the reaction to it?
See, like most things, the community seems to be a little divided. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking from queer women perspective. Mm-hmm. So some of them found it really good, hot,
it's pretty hot,
steamy,
I gotta tell you.
The fact that, there is a clearly lack of content or conversation within that space. So there are a lot of people who appreciated it. Then the other side is like it's still who've been critical about it because mm-hmm. they personally feel that they cannot identify with it or that it still is put out there in order to appeal to the male gaze. Mm-hmm. So not really.
Yeah, because these are two very sort of like, hot women and like sort of they could have chosen anybody else, right, to do this.
I mean Monica Dogra, right, but Anushka Manchanda is not your conventionally hot looking woman if you look
she's
at
quite
it.
Hot.
I mean I think she's pretty
she's
hot.
Tall and lanky body. So yeah, two tall lanky women. Personally I would
but they're
say,
celebrities, so I suppose that's what creates a buzz, right?
Yeah, I mean, and why not have celebrities, right?
Yeah, no.
Personally, for me, the video did not do much. Mm-hmm. I don't like that kind of music, so I think that is what...
I don't know how many people are watching it for the music.
So for me, the image disconnect was just there. Yeah. I couldn't sit through it. For me, like I said, I didn't do it. But I still, personally, I feel that it's still a very good... it's good. I mean, I come from a point of view that any conversation is good conversation.
Yeah.
Right. As long as it gets people to talk. Because I've seen on forums, there's been a lot of chatting about it, a lot of conversations around it, whether pro or anti, whatever.
Yeah.
But at least it's got people to talk. At least it's got queer women to talk. So I suppose that's where it's been. I mean, it's done its job.
Yeah, and also because, I find that in films, for instance, there have been a lot of, there've been movies about gay relationships, but like queer women are hardly ever depicted in mainstream or indie cinema. Like, for instance, you've had movies like My Brother
Fire.
Nickel
and Fire
was like the one of the few, and then again had a big controversy with Fire where they had to sort of stop screening it because they burnt down theaters that were actually screening it, but also that because it had these mythological associations, I think, right? Fire.
But yeah, it was back in the day. Right?
Yeah, it was back in the day.
And in fact, a lot has changed since then.
In fact, Gaysi recently screened a film which has a queer theme.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. But like I said, I mean, lots has changed if you look at India. I mean, from the time we started the blog back in 2008, from then to now a lot. Yeah. I mean, you have queer film festivals running at popular commercial spaces. I mean, we had
Kashish
one in Juhu.
Is,
exactly. Yeah, we had, I mean, the first Kashish I attended was in Juhu PVR, you know, where I saw a lot of young people, irrespective of their gender or sexuality, coming and just coming there to see films or hang with their friends. So we can't really compare.
What
I don't know if Fire was supposed to release now. I don't know how well. I would say even for that, the community would have been divided.
Right.
Some pro, some anti. Like for me, my opinion of that film changed over time. Mm-hmm. The more sensitized, the more informed I got, then I started looking at the film very differently.
Right.
Earlier, it was more like, you know, there's finally a film in the Indian context talking about queer women. So,
right. Well, you know, let's talk about Gaysi itself. You've been doing a lot of events lately. I mean, I think the frequency of your events has gone up. I mean, I just mentioned a film that you guys screen is called Capital I, which has a sort of a queer theme to it. You've also done a really, really popular and amazing show called Tape, which we talked about in an earlier episode. It's also known as the Gentleman's Club. You have a New Year party coming up. So has Gaysi just been more active lately?
See, we started our events back in 2012. We started with our open mic called Dirty Talk, which was part of the Mumbai Pride month. We did two events at that time. We realized that there was space, or rather need, to have such events in informal spaces, in a, you know, fun commercial spaces, though, where people just come hang out. So it becomes a social space to interact as well. Plus, you have because the three of us who are part of Gaysi, I mean, we firmly believe that we need to push a lot of creative content out there. So just having a vanilla party doesn't really appeal to our senses. So we thought, you know, we can throw these kind of performances in such fun spaces. And that's how we started with Dirty Talk. And once we became a bit more comfortable and confident, and we realized that, you know, if you do fun stuff, people will come. What it also did was that it did not only bring out queer people, but also straight people. So today, if you see of our open mics, in terms of performances, we have a lot of straight people who are talking about queer content on stage. Mm-hmm. And you have a lot of straight people who come and participate and support.
I mean, I think this time, the last Dirty Talk that you did, you had a lot of people, theatre people, who are fairly well-known in the theatre space, performed at the Dirty Talk.
We've always had that.
Right.
What we do is, so if we have about 10 performances, we have about 7 from the community, from the call-out, and about 3 of them will be, you know, people that we invite. So we try and get somebody from the music space, theatre space, stand-up. So it's a very intentional initiative from our end to ensure that we get people from those genres on stage.
Okay.
And these rotate venues, do you have like a fixed space?
We try and keep it around Bandra area, because we've realized that it works best for us, because it's quite central for everybody. But we keep changing venues. There are some that we stick to primarily for an event like Dirty Talk, where we have over 300 people coming. You don't have that many spaces in Mumbai that can cater to that big crowd.
So then, something you'll have used.
Yeah. We've used it about 3 times.
Yeah, it's an interesting space, actually.
It's an interesting space. I mean, I think I watched Tape there for the second time.
I thought Tape really worked there.
It did, because it has a slight... It looks a bit like a boudoir.
Yeah.
Like, it has a slightly, you know, seedy vibe. And
in fact,
so
we saw it twice. We also saw it at...
We saw it at...
Dilt.
Which has shut down, I think, right?
Yeah, it has.
So. It has. Yeah. But that was an interesting space as well for that show.
And it was first time for all of us. First time for us to do a theatre production, and first time for Patchworks to do it in an informal space like a club. But the Tape night, I mean the Tilt night, I think the second show till date, we have people walk up to us and say it was just something else.
With
respect
to
people behind the, you know, on the stage, behind backstage, and the audience, I mean, the vibe, the atmosphere that evening was just
that
crazy.
Particular show, was it a collaborative effort? I mean, did you guys put your heads together to think of the story, the narrative?
Not in terms of the story. We Vikram Phukan, who's a dear friend and who's part of the community, had participated in our previous Dirty Talk with a small drag queen performance. So he approached us saying that, you know, he has patchworks in mind and he thinks we should do a drag king show. So we said, all right. And we went through the draft of the story and we liked it. And so then they went and prepped up on it. And the only thing where we stepped in was to ensure that, you know, the play is sensitive enough, you know, the technical terms, the political terms are correct and things like that. So that's where we kind of helped him. Otherwise, we've just looked purely in terms of marketing and putting the show out there. Like,
right.
And what's great is that it's actually been staged at a mainstream venue like NCPA, right? Didn't it go on to be staged there?
It was at the Center Stage Festival at NCPA, and it was also at Prithvi. The last shows were at Prithvi.
You know, as mainstream as you can get as far as theatre venues are in Bombay.
Yeah. You talked about, you know, the political terms. Now, is this something that you get a lot? People saying politically incorrect things and... How do you deal with that? Like, are you prickly about it, or do you have a sense of humor about it?
I mean, what we tell ourselves regularly is to pick our battles wisely. To be honest, what we've realized over the years is that not necessarily the other person is homophobic or something. They're probably just ignorant. So, so it's always good to kind of correct them rather than just jump with a hammer on them. I mean, there are many times when we are incorrect. You know, our sexuality and gender today are just so fluid. We learn every day. There are just so many things coming out. So it's all about how well you keep yourself informed. But no, I won't kill
you. Yeah,
because
this is a you know, little debate that we were having, and I'm always
and Prawn was very scared that I was going to say something politically incorrect. But yeah. I will ask you a question, which is, you know, we were talking a little bit earlier about how Gaysi has evolved, and it started out as like a blog or as a zine, and now it's sort of grown to this thing where you, down the line from 2008 to 2013, you'll actually formed a company and it's sort of formalized organization. So do you just want to tell us a little bit about, you know, the background and how things have progressed?
So Gaysi was started in 2008 primarily just as a space for queer women to share stories. Indian queer women to share stories.
And there were three founders or four founders?
Two, okay. It was me and another friend of mine who lives in UK. So both of us were bloggers previously anyways. So we decided, why not have a multiple author blog and try and get in touch with as many people, as many women, queer women we know, and just simple, just share stories. So that's where we started. And it kind of like grew in the sense that then we had... more members from the queer community coming to us, I mean, sending in their contribution or, you know, wanting to ask certain things. So we had gay men, bisexuals, trans people coming on board. And that's how we grew. So it was, we were never very fussy about who should contribute, who shouldn't. We've had contribution even from straight people. We have contribution from people who consider themselves queer. So as long as you know, as long as there is something that you would like to share, we are pretty open to putting it up on the blog. Then back in 2012 is when we did our first event as part, like I said, as part of the Mumbai Pride month. And that's where we started with our offline events, which then from an open mic evolved to having workshops, book readings, film screenings, then theatre, then having alternate month bar nights.
Right. I mean... Now, you know, just we were just having a conversation before we started recording, and you said that there's not that much conversation as far as queer women is concerned. So, I mean, are there any other organizations like Gaysi, or do you see yourself as, you know, just one of the bigger organizations talking about queer women issues?
I don't see any in social spaces. There are a lot of support groups. There are a lot of NGOs who primarily cater to queer women, but not a space like Gaysi, I would say, out there.
Right. Okay. So you have a New Year party coming up. So do you want to tell us a bit about that? I mean, you know, what date it's on and how people can sign up?
So... we've been hosting our bar nights. It's called 2x2 bar night. we've hosted about two till now, and what we got feedback was, so it's an open bar night, so anybody can come. So feedback that we got was, why not host at least one or two bar nights, which are just for the LGBT women, basically queer women. So we thought about it. We try to be very inclusive with everything. Mm-hmm. So it was a little debate within whether to go ahead with something or not. And then we said, why not? Mm-hmm. Might as well try for a New Year's Eve party. So we decided to go ahead. We spoke to Diggy at Den, found a place. So it's on 31st night, $400 with a free drink.
And okay. Yeah. Okay, and it's so in the Den in Bandra.
So this is for LGBT women. No straight women. And no men.
How are you going
women
to like,
and queer women.
What kind of crowd control is going to be there?
crowd screening. We have our own bouncers, by the way. For all our events, we have our own bouncers.
Okay. Yes. Cool. That's great.
Cool. And do you want to tell us where people can follow everything that you guys do? The website, the Facebook.
So the website is www.gaysifamily.com. Mm-hmm. And you can follow us. I mean, we are very regular with Facebook. So that's at Gaysi Family. And okay. Instagram, Twitter. All at Gaysi Family. So
okay,
super. Great. Thanks, Sakshi, for talking to us. And so this is Sakshi from Gaysi Family. Do check out the website. There's some great stories over there. Also, you know, we constantly list Gaysi Family events. So do check our weekend guide, which is published on Friday. We normally have one event which is being done by Gaysi. So see you next week.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Excuse me, भैया. Excuse me.
बोलिए मैडम.
मेन्यू में क्या है?
मेन्यू में सीन अनसीन है, पॉडकास्ट है, ऑनकोर्स है, साइरस है, मेड इन इंडिया, रीडिस्कवरी प्रोजेक्ट, एम्पावरिंग सीरीज, सेक्स वेक्स है, आईवीएम लाइक्स है, सिंप्लीफाइड है, कीपिंग इट क्वियर है, ड्रिंक्स एंड डेस्टिनेशन है, माय नेबर ज़करबर्ग है और द फैन गैराज है. आपको क्या चाहिए?
एक बार रिपीट कर देंगे क्या?
रिपीट नहीं करता हम. आप जाओ ivmpodcast.com पे और सुनो ये सब, या फिर डाउनलोड करो उनका ऐप. सब आपकी उंगलियों पे.